Okay. Well, welcome everyone. Let's see. Let's start with FAQs since we don't have health with us just yet. I did have a question for everyone. I had sent around an introductory piece for the ventilation FAQ, and Stephanie just pointed out to me that it wasn't part of the final version that went out to the task force. So we would need to amend it. But honestly, I'm asking whether that's even necessary. I think the document in and of itself, as James has produced it with some input from us, but mostly thanks to James, I'm not really sure it needs an introduction. I think, you know, the definitions and the information is pretty clear and straightforward. When I sent the introduction out, I don't think I had any feedback. I think we can just go with it as it is, pending, I think, a few changes that were going to be finalized before it was posted. Stephanie?
So the Google Docs version that the full task force got the last time has your introduction.
Oh, I'm sorry. I guess I misunderstood our correspondence.
Well, I was asking you about it. Then I found it. Then I added it last week. And so the current Google Doc has the introduction.
Okay, then we should leave it in, I think, since that's what the task force.
Either way, I just wanted
okay.
to.
Thank you.
And I just want to say that I've been unable to make the edits that were talked about last week. So they're going to have to be in the next, you know, before the end of this week. But Stephanie, you had prompted me, and I'm just behind at the moment.
Figured you had lots of good excuses. So, but we want to be including that, those extra comments and questions with the final, and then figure out, well, we have two different versions that will, two platforms for the same content. One is we need a simple PDF that the chamber can share, but then, as we've all discussed, a web page, which I've created, it has the links to the different sections of the FAQs, and it's all hidden at the moment. As soon as we get a final, we can make that live. And then I can go back to converting the other two FAQs into that same format.
Is there anything that prevents us for it being live, even if it's not? Because my sense is that there'll be more questions, we'll answer more questions on an ongoing basis.
I mean, I can make it live, put a link from the task force immediately, and then as you get a chance to add the additional question and answer and all that, we can just add them. Yeah. I'll just hold off on creating the PDF, but we can certainly provide the link to the web page to Valerie, to all the members of the task force, to share with whomever they might want to. Which leads me to one authorship question, which is how comfortable are you, James, with putting your name and expertise on this? I do think it needs some authorship to say why the health subcommittee opinion should be taken seriously. But we have a ventilation expert, and I think that's really critical. Kim is calling me, so.
Let's take that call.
Good morning.
Welcome, Kristen. Well, let's see.
Kim was looking for sign in. I'm sending that. In the meantime, James, how do you feel about authoring this?
I feel okay. I think one way of doing that may be that we use our task force letterhead, which includes the people on the health subcommittee and their credentials.
Well, we would do that in the PDF version. But that isn't what the web page is. The web page is a web page. So
I'm happy to have my name, my name and my company name on that.
Okay. Yeah. And I can certainly put there that you are co-chair of the task force and a member of this committee.
Sounds
That'll
great.
Suffice. Thank you.
I would like to, for tomorrow, I would like I think the intent of the task force last week that was that this was approved. So I would like to show up tomorrow and say that it's available. It's been made available.
I will send that link. And then the other parallel question is for the PDFs of, well, question for the health department as to whether we add a link to this document and the other FAQs from the health COVID page, and or in the format of that, we can either link to the page or put the PDFs in the sidebar where you have links to other PDFs.
I know that question is for the health department, but may I comment, Kim, before you reply? I'm concerned that people can't find the information that we're posting. And so, you know, we're spending a lot of time on these FAQs, and I'm not sure that they're really helping the public. I posed this question to Stephanie earlier, but I'm not sure if we can go any further with it because she didn't have a quick and ready answer, and I kind of dropped it. But I'd like to know how many views these have had and whether anyone is downloading them, if it's possible, and if there's someone in your IT department who could easily do that. I asked a friend just to take a look and see if she could find it and whether it was easy for her. And as I thought would happen, she said yes, but she didn't get to where I wanted her to get. She got to the health department, the banner across the top of the city page where it says COVID-19. And she looked around and she never did come across our FAQs. So I want to put that out there before you answer Stephanie's question.
I'm going to ask Kristen if she can answer Stephanie's question because I was late and I didn't hear the whole conversation. Were you able to hear it, Kristen?
No, I was not actually in this room until just 2 minutes ago. I came on after you.
So I'm sorry.
There are two questions. One of them is, can we track viewership of pages? Yes, as I said before, I can get that information from Alan Brady, who's our IT guy. That doesn't have anything to do with the health department. The second question is, on your landing page for COVID within the health department, there's a sidebar that has some links to other documents. The question is whether we put the FAQ, there are three FAQs for masks, for testing, and now for ventilation issues, if it is appropriate or logical to put those on that page.
I believe it is. We probably just need to make it clear that it's the subcommittee's work.
Okay.
It might be faster if Stephanie does it, but Stephanie, I can assist with that if need be.
Okay. Yeah, I can add the two that we've already done and that are formatted and there are on the task force letterhead, but also in the name of the document on that page, I'll put the task force. And you know, if you see it and you want me to change it, that's easy. So we'll do both of those things and provide the link to the page with the ventilation FAQs. As an overall comment, there is so much on the city website that, I mean, you're burdened with walking into a library and confronted with all of these books. It is a difficulty of the architecture of our website that if you are not using the actual name of whatever you're looking for in the search box, you won't find it because the search box does not search the content of a page or a document, it only searches the title. So I try to be very careful about trying to guess what people are going to think they're looking for when I name things, but that is an issue. I think the usefulness of the website is that it gives anybody who knows what's there a really easy here if somebody says, what's the information about FAQs on masks? We can give them a link and send that to an email. I would not be surprised to find the analytics for the page to be slim to none.
Kim?
Stephanie, you know how we have the icons on the bottom of the pages for of the different departments, like one for permits, one for fines or fees or whatever? Could that be fixed by just putting a COVID button on the health department page, and when they click on that, they get everything COVID related?
Yes, certainly. People do seem to be finding the tab right up at the top of the homepage of the city. But yes, I mean, the easier we make it for people to access it, the better. The challenge with these FAQs is that we have so much other information on the COVID, on the health COVID webpage, quarantining, all of that stuff, that people don't look comprehensively. I do think that if we can put the FAQs on a very short list, like the sidebar, it's easier to find.
Can we put the FAQs, or is there too many words, on channel 22, like one FAQ per slide to sort of rotate?
Not the best. There's a lot of content. It would be exhausting to go through it all on channel 22, but to highlight that the information's there and refer people to the place to find them, absolutely.
I agree with Anne. A lot of hard work and really good work has gone into those. We want them to be used as much as possible. So if you could do something like that with Channel 22, I've heard from several people that Channel 22 is where they first realized that there was information about COVID. So at least enough Portsmouth people tend to watch it. And if it's, they're waiting for like a city council meeting to come on and that flashes by, I think that'd be great. Thank you.
Do we need to have any approval from the task force to advertise them, for lack of a better word?
James?
I don't think so, because the intent is if we publish something that people have access to it. I think we're good.
All right.
Before we leave the FAQs, now that there's going to be a supply of antigen tests in New Hampshire, it doesn't appear that they're going to be locally in the Seacoast yet, but they're going to be available in New Hampshire. Should we somehow or other make that information available, only because it allows for rapid testing?
If I may, I just finished a conversation with area multi-coordinating entities and the hospitals and our public health network. They don't really know how the antigen testing is going to, you mean the rapid kits from the press release this morning? Most of them are supposedly going to be available for school use and for long-term care facilities. We don't have the specifics. We are also working with the high school. They're getting CLIA certified so that they can host one of those, so that as a means of keeping kids in school and not having to close an entire school if you have one classroom that's affected. But there's just not enough details, I think, to put out valid information yet.
Because part of the part of my bringing it forward is it's not just the press release was also in the paper, so people reading may wonder, can I get this here because I want immediate results?
Yeah, but the answer to that would be I don't know.
I know. I just brought it up as a question.
I do think it's possible. When we have the testing FAQs as a web page, that we could add that question and simply say exactly what Kim just said. I know the governor a member of the HHS presented it last week at the press conference as intended for schools and long-term care facilities. So I think if we say that, we're good.
Where and how would we say that? Would we add that to the FAQ? Is that what you're suggesting?
Right.
And that's the sort of a minor change, James, as we discussed last week, that would not need to go back to the task force.
Can I just say here that we talk about antigen testing already in the FAQ as an option. So it's not like we'd be introducing anything new. It's just in the testing sites, we say these are all PCR sites because we don't have an antigen site. So I don't see it as something that would need approval personally.
No, I think it could just be an update in your report to the task force and where you're just providing information.
Okay. All right. So it will. We will add just language from the press release, and I'll just announce it tomorrow. That did I understand everybody correctly? That's what we want to do.
Yeah. If you find that it's important to announce as part of your report.
Well, it's not just up to me. It seems like that's the consensus that this is important enough to report. I'm surprised I didn't see the press release, but I thought we were expecting them in October or November. So that's.
I think given the fact that the restaurant people brought up last week about how waiting so long for test results is problematic in terms of their employees, I think if they read this, they're going to be wondering how can they get access to this. So I think if we bring it up and say we don't have local access right now and we're following it, that would be helpful.
Okay. And, you know, another item on our FAQ discussion is FAQ maintenance. I have to be honest, I haven't looked through masks, but I plan to do that this week. But I did notice when I was looking at the health department's COVID site that there is information in there about testing availability in the city, within the city. I think it's all within the city limits. And I can't remember if that's Tony or Kristen who's following that. But if we have a link to our testing FAQ, then I wonder, do we need to have that in both places or should we cross-reference them so that we make sure that they are both saying the same thing? And I haven't compared them to make sure they are saying the same thing. But I know that's been something that changes pretty frequently.
Yeah, I keep track of that. And so, the information in the FAQs from on testing came from Kristen and Tony. So yes, it should be consistent. I haven't compared it word to word.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone object if we skip over the daily life or household readiness for the time being? Because I haven't seen a big demand for that. And we have some other items to discuss that could eat up some time that I don't want to neglect. For example, the plastic barriers and a couple of other items. Everybody okay if we skip over the daily life for now?
Yeah, yes.
All right then, let's move on to, health. Let's do a couple of things that might be quick within the health, and there's so much overlap between health and public information right now, but we had an email from you, Stephanie, about Halloween advice. I don't see any action item for this task force in there. Was that just intended as an FYI, or is that anything the health department or you, Stephanie, wants to discuss?
It was just an FYI for me. The city hasn't set policy. There's a meeting later this week.
Okay. Similarly, the Greek Orthodox Church outbreak, that was just FYI. Nothing we need to discuss there, am I right?
Well, it's kind of important. Could I take a minute?
Yeah.
So there was discussion in the beginning of this that, you know, church and state, you have to be careful because of the separation rules and stuff. And so we have churches, you know, a lot of our churches stop their traditions of, you know, people drinking out of the same cup, going up to the altar to receive communion, that sort of thing. But we do have one church that's been in flux, and they've gone through a lot of changes because of this issue. But the Boston organization that sort of sees the local churches was saying that they don't need to stop their practices of going up and receiving communion from a shared spoon and that sort of thing. And in that church, there happened to be an outbreak. And the AG's office had been telling people that they have to stop those practices, but the only time I've seen that written down was a letter that was sent out to the church that had this outbreak saying those practices are not allowed, and this is not a suggestion, this is required. You know, anywhere in the governor's guidelines where it says shall or should, you have to comply even if you're a church, and that does not matter the denomination. So because this is where things have gone really wrong across the country, we are sending out a letter from the health department to all of the churches quoting the AG's information in it, just so it's clear. And so that should go out, I don't know about this afternoon, I'm hoping, certainly before Sunday, but I think it's really important, and that's one of the points where we're going to go off track if we're going to go off track if something isn't done to change that. And now that we have the new mask ordinance, people in a church are going to have to wear masks anyhow, so that also helps.
Good, good. That's good to know. Yeah, I know it's important, but I don't see any action item for our subcommittee. Is that correct? But it's good to know that, as usual, health department's on top of everything. Thank you. So the dividers in restaurants, let's move on to that. I sent the information out because we had promised last week that we would update, that we would be following this. And so I did decide, once the information was posted on the state website, to send it out. There was a little bit of controversy. I think my language maybe wasn't careful enough. I didn't mean to suggest that we were, I said that we were not endorsing, and what I meant was we haven't had a chance to discuss what we're going to do. But there was some concern that people would take that to mean that we disagreed with it. Maybe we do and maybe we don't, but we need to reach some kind of consensus about this. So apologies for any confusion that may have caused. I did receive one private reply from a restaurateur who said, I agree with you and we're not going to be using those. So clearly he understood it to say the health committee is not in favor of this. What can or should we be doing about this? Kim, I look to you to kick off the discussion.
Well, Kristen, Tony, and I discussed this and started working on it with the fire department yesterday. I just want to be clear that we get this information the same time everybody else does, so there's no like working on it prior to a press release coming out from the governor's office. But what it boils down to is the governor has said that you can use barriers within restaurants and not maintain the 6 feet of space. Of course, when you're indoors in a restaurant and you're going to eat, you cannot wear a mask if you're eating. And so it, you know, it's worrisome. But I went to the governor, had a little gathering out at Newex last Friday. And he talked about this, lifting the restriction. And one of our restaurants asked him, what is the science behind that decision? And the governor said that there are studies in other cities, or that they looked at other cities, where they allowed these barriers without the distancing and they were not experiencing outbreaks. So I have asked Department of Health and Human Services to share with us what those studies were or where that information came from, just so that we can all be on the same page. If that's the case, that's great. I've not heard back from DHHS, and I asked, I think Friday or Thursday or Friday. So given that, the situation is we understand that there are businesses that if they don't increase their indoor capacity as winter comes, they aren't going to survive. And so, you know, we have to try to help these businesses to get open. However, in my mind, that doesn't mean necessarily 100%. And I've had a conversation with a couple people yesterday that deal a lot with our businesses. And what I'd like to have restaurants think of is, what is their capacity that they need to have a viable business, and maybe start with that, or start even slower than that. We heard feedback that a lot of restaurants don't want to do this. They don't want their atmosphere being destroyed by plastic barriers. They don't want people coming in and seeing them disinfecting the barriers. They think it's going to be really cumbersome. It's a lot of expense. You know, and then other people were all for it. They want to increase their occupancy as much as they possibly can. So we're going into an unknown with this. I'll feel much better if the Department of Health and Human Services sends us those studies or those, you know, examples of cities that have done this successfully. But so it's a real balancing act. We have to help businesses try to survive, but we don't want to destroy everything everyone sacrificed so much for to this point. So that's where we stand with it. It requires barriers. They do have to have knot holes and gaps. There are some guidelines that the governor puts out as to how they have to be constructed and used. But I'm very interested in what people on this committee think about this.
Well, what I'd like to add is that it's not just adding barriers. The restaurant also needs to work with their mechanical contractor to make sure that they have, the barrier is not going to block their ventilation and their air circulation.
James, if I can respond, thank you for bringing that up. That's right, and that's going to take time if every restaurant in Portsmouth is calling an HVAC company. So we did send out an email last night to our food service permittees letting them know that the original HVAC requirement is still in place, where you have to increase ventilation, air exchanges, bring in outside air. That still remains a requirement. And then if you're going to increase your indoor seating from what you're allowed to now with our COVID distancing, there's this additional requirement that those plans have to be run by an HVAC person to make sure it's not going to interfere with ventilation. And so our restaurants have that information to start this process, but that's as far as we've gotten with outreach to the restaurants. And we'll be sending out another email probably tomorrow with how they can apply for indoor seating. So again, really interested in what this group has to say.
All right, I saw Bianca and then Kathy, please.
So I was just looking at a few things here while we were talking about this, and I went to PubMed. So there's no scientific articles that I can't find so far. I'm gonna dig a little deeper into this, but no scientific articles. What I did find in a lot of other states, health departments like yours, Kim, giving guidance. And I found one, and I'll share this, just if I can share my screen really quickly.
Hold on, let me set, oh geez, what did I do here? I did the wrong thing. I pressed the wrong button. There you go,
Bianca. So I found this one, I think it's from Washington State. Can I do it?
Yeah, you should be able to.
It's open right there. So I just wanna show this really quick. It's giving guidance to business, not just restaurants, but business in general to do the plexiglass. And this is what I found. So they're doing a hierarchy of controls. So they find the plexiglass as kind of a middle sort of intention of safety, but it would still be required to have changed the way people work. I think putting locations of the employees, right? And then PPE, which will probably be a mask. So I think this is what tells us is, I think plexiglass may protect, but again, you still need extra layers of protection, which will be probably ventilation in restaurants and masks, which we can't do in restaurants, right? So then we'll be a higher risk.
I'll go after Kathy.
So my question is really kind of quick, Kim. Did they say how close the tables can be? Before they had to be 6 feet apart. Is there any separation now at all? I didn't see any in what I read.
You're saying, you know, I don't remember reading that either, but Kristen or Tony, do you remember?
No, there's no.
There isn't.
No.
I think I read something about 5. It now can be decreased to 5 feet.
I think that was a typo on something that was sent to us.
Yeah. And they also said that there must be adequate airflow and air exchange with these barriers.
With the fire department does have a requirement for tables to be, I think it might be 36 inches apart for egress reasons. So it might default to that. I don't know.
I guess it's my turn. I was just going to say the pyramid that you showed us, Bianca, two things I noticed was that it was for workplace in general, not restaurants. So, you know, protective equipment, as Kim already pointed out, that people won't have masks on. And the other thing is, I just thought it was odd that they had engineering highlighted with reference to plastic, but didn't say anything right there about airflow. That's just what I noticed about that pyramid.
That was the original guidance, I think, way back in the beginning from when business started to put plexiglass supermarkets, cashiers. so that it doesn't go into detail for the restaurant. So I'm trying to find a good one for restaurants. There's really not much. It's just general guidelines for plexiglass.
I'm suspicious that that statement just came from the fact that there hasn't been any publicized outbreaks associated with restaurants with plexiglass. And I mean, we have a big country with a lot of restaurants. Who knows whether or not that would get published?
Yes. And honestly, getting answers to those difficult questions about these guidelines has been very difficult since COVID started. It's almost if there's not a clear answer, we don't get one at all. So I'll still keep working on it. What I do want to let this group know, though, is that so we've already, in September is when we re-permit our restaurants, all of them. And so most people, most restaurants in town have already gone through that permitting process. We still have some that left to go before October 1st when their current permit expires. And people are being permitted right now for COVID spacing, for 6 feet apart. And if they want to put in additional seatings with these barriers, they need to show us the seating plan with the barriers, and we'll be evaluating that along with the statement, or along with, they'll let us know who their HVAC company was that actually reviewed this and said that's okay. I think that's going to take a little bit of time. But if a restaurant, say they open and there are problems, there's an outbreak associated with it, and it's tied to the restaurant itself, they will have to go, even if they increase numbers, they will have to go back to those COVID numbers, because they've been operating with those seats inside safely up to this point. We know of no outbreaks in Portsmouth associated with restaurants that we know of. And the state does tend to, if we hear something and I call people, I know I do tend to get an answer from the people that I work with routinely, but they don't notify us of outbreaks in places in Portsmouth, which is another problem with communication over this whole thing. But then they'd go back down to those safe numbers, and that's where I think they would have to stay. And so we do have that safety mechanism in there for this. But again, we're open to any thoughts and ideas that you have.
Kathy?
I'm just going to speak personally. I think if a restaurant had a known COVID outbreak, that would just almost be a death knell for that restaurant.
Yes, but and the governor made that point when he spoke the other day, that no, you know, that will kill your business. But, you know, we're asking them to go into an unknown if they do this, or they're being forced to, because they, you know, with outdoor seating going away, a lot of businesses just can't survive at 25%. So I think they're going to have to take some steps to try to increase seating. And I think a very slow approach with a few seats at a time is the best. But if that's how it's going to happen, we need to have that happen while there's still outdoor seating available. And we only have another month of that.
James, and then Kathy.
Yeah, I just want to say that last week I had concerns about the partitions, and that they would block airflow. So the fact that the guidelines came out with, you know, it's not just about partitions, it's about doing it in concert with making sure your circulation there is there, and that's part of the guideline. So I agree with Kim that, you know, our charge of supporting the reopening, I was really glad to see that the air circulation part was in there as part of the partitioning. If it was just plexiglass is okay, I'd still have the same concern I did last week, but I don't have that concern, and I think it's a good measure, because it feels comprehensive to me.
I know that this goes without being said, but I think part of it in being successful is making sure that all of the other mandates are followed, you know, particularly with regard to mask wearing whenever you get up from the table. And I know that falls back on the restaurant employees in terms of trying to make sure people follow those rules. But to me, following all the other rules will be what may make partitions successful.
Okay, thank you. And then I think I saw Kristen next.
James, sorry. James, I have a quick question for you. This came up on a call I was on right before I joined this. I can't think of anybody in Portsmouth this might apply to, but if we have a very small operator without an HVAC system in their space, I'm not sure how they would meet this requirement. And again, I can't think of anybody off the top of my head that has seating indoors this might apply to, but because it came up, I wanted to just ask your opinion.
Yeah, it's a possible scenario where someone doesn't have a ducted system that's providing air conditioning and heating. That is a possible scenario. An option for them may be that they have operable windows, which as the weather gets cold, that's problematic. So I think there's going to be a lot of different scenarios, but what you just described is a possible scenario, and I can't think of one off the top of my head, but we have a lot of very old buildings, and some of them are bound to not have ductwork in the seating area.
Did anyone have a hand up that I missed? Well, to summarize then, it sounds to me like we're not ready to make any recommendation. We're still waiting more information. For example, Kim, a reply from, I think it was Dr. Chan or from someone at the state. So I can just say that tomorrow, that we want to keep you informed. We are not taking a stand on this at this point in time. We understand the difficulties the businesses are facing, but that we don't have scientific evidence to take a stand on this at this point in time. And we'll keep you posted. Kim? And then Jane?
Just want to be clear that we sort of have to move forward to some degree, even before we get that information. And I'll try the state again. So if they could give us what they read, I think it'd be very helpful and speed this up. But so the health department has to sort of continue to move forward with this without a recommendation from the group, but please, please do speak with us. And keep in mind, we've done this successfully. The whole community has done this successfully to date. And it was done very carefully and very slowly. And so I do think the way forward is slow, make sure it's safe, another step forward, make sure it's safe, and so on and so forth. My goal is still, when the school department feels that they can do it, to get kids back in school as often and for as long as possible. And so it just, every time some piece of the community moves forward in a different direction, I worry about what the effect is gonna be on the kids.
James, before you speak, if I may just say, Kim, the farthest thing from my mind is ever to impede you from doing your job or to have the health subcommittee take over any part of your job. Believe me. James?
Yeah, I just want to add that the nature of what we're dealing with, we can't wait for all the data we'd like to have. It's going to be available someday. Maybe the pandemic will be over when we have the data we want. So I would agree with Kim that we have to move forward. It seems reasonable. And if it starts to result in bad news, and then the community has to respond to that. So I'm not even sure that we have to take a position on it. This is a personal opinion of mine. And a lot of people, I believe, is that there's been a lack of central leadership on dealing with the pandemic. And a lot of things have been put onto the states, and the states are putting a lot of things onto local communities. And I personally don't think that's the way to battle a pandemic. So my point is that if the state comes out with guidance, whether it's providing lenience or strictness, I'm generally in favor of the state taking responsibility and providing leadership in the pandemic. And so in this case, it's lenience, but I would expect that they're also responsible for leadership on restriction when it's warranted. So that's just my personal opinion, that the more central leadership is on dealing with a global pandemic, the better off we are.
Kim?
Well, James, you're absolutely right. And this is not how this is supposed to have played out. And this is not how public health planning has gone for the last 20 years. It, you know, there was supposed to be sentinel services overseas that would have seen this coming and would have done more to stop it. There should have been a federal control. That's how we're all trained. There should have been federal resources. So it's been very difficult. And the governor himself said the other day, so, you know, we leave it to the locals. So that's where we are. But I did want to ask a question about the operation of this group. So when something, knock on wood, it doesn't, but if something goes wrong in the community, and Kristen and Tony and I have to put our heads together and come up with the fastest, most effective way to deal with it, is it possible to call this group together to discuss something like that if it's not a regular meeting? Would that be appropriate?
That's an extremely good question, because the past couple of weeks I've brought up the question of what is the scope of our activities and what are we authorized to do and what do we want to do? And I actually happened to run into Bianca downtown this morning. We actually got to meet face to face, which was wonderful. And we talked about this a little bit, but I am concerned, you know, we started off with, when we got the pop-up and the street subcommittees going in the right direction and accomplishing what they needed to accomplish, we were asked to give suggestions for what we should do next. And if you'll recall, this subcommittee was generated because I suggested that we should be looking at the data on a regular basis. And that was really all I had in mind. So, I mean, it's really grown, and I understand that it's possible, although I've not heard it directly, that some people have a problem with some of the things that we've been trying to accomplish. So I really think that this question brings up a whole new topic. What are we doing? What should we be doing? What limitations do we want to put on ourselves? The last few weeks, we haven't even been able to get through everything. There's so much on our agenda. So I'm not answering your question, but I'm just broadening it, I would say.
Yeah, I have, let's see if I can put it into context. I think that you've appreciated the technical support from this group, Kim, and I think under that, in that way, I think this group can be a resource to you. Another point is that if we think about the charge of the task force, it's to have more voices involved in how to safely reopen and support businesses. So I think it fits with that mandate. And then the other point I would make is that this group is, by its nature, the going to represent the health aspect. And it's going to place emphasis on health from a technical standpoint. And that's why I think it's important that our recommendations go to the full task force, because you're going to have a check and balance where this group may tend to be more conservative because we're looking at the health consequences, whereas the task force at large might be more representative and have recommendations to feedback to the city manager and other city employees, just weighing and balancing the trade-offs. There's a certain amount of risk aversion that I think it's helpful for this committee to share. And then there's a certain amount of more passion. You know, we have some business owners, we have some restaurateurs. There might be, there's trade-offs, you know, and just like our discussion with the barriers indoors, that's a trade-off. We're all willing to take on a little risk because of the case caseload that currently exists. If the caseload were to change, then that willingness to take on that risk would change. So I think those are just a few comments that I would make relative to the role of this committee and how it can continue to support city staff, including Kim.
Kim, and then I'll go.
Thank you. Yeah, those are good points. That makes me feel much more comfortable being reminded of the you know, charges that were given. We know that the health and the economy are hand in hand. You have to have both of them stepping forward together, and that's where this group has been really great with technical support, seeing other ways that we can do that and still maintain the health and the low numbers, which is what we need to keep going forward. And I just want to let this committee know for this discussion that there is a whole host of other things that are coming. Even if our numbers stay low and we are doing great, now we're going into this whole vaccine distribution planning, all relying on volunteers and public health networks and, you know, city staff, whatever we can come up with. But that is a big discussion. We have four different vaccine types. We have handling requirements. We have populations that it has to be decided who they're going to go to first. And so if this committee continues, I just want to know that there's a whole bunch of things that we're working on that we haven't even brought to this committee. So there's plenty of work to do, is my point.
All I wanted to say was that I find it extremely discouraging that you would even need to call our subcommittee together, because you're the health department. I mean, if people won't listen to what the health department has to say, I'm just very concerned about that. And I know there's been a lot of trouble at City Hall, non-meetings and that sort of thing. So I don't know what's going on, but that's too bad.
I want to be clear. People do listen to the health department. We do have laws behind us. This is not because we're in a place of trouble. This is because this committee has done so much good work so quickly that if we, all these situations we go into are pretty complicated. And so we're not just dealing with, here's an outbreak. We're dealing with, you know, how does a business go on? What can't go on? How does it affect the schools? How does it affect our nursing homes? And so my question was simply, if we get to a point where we're moving forward and we want to hear your opinions in case there's something we didn't think of, that was what I was getting at. Or if we run it by you and you say, oh, wait a minute, did you think of something over here? That was my reason. And I have to say it's been a hard 6 months for us, but that's because of the workload. The community has actually been pretty good overall.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for clarifying my misconception there. Well,
and just one,
James,
just one final point on that. I think we can be there to support the health department. And then I think our role in terms of transparency with the full task force is just when we report on a weekly basis to the task force, we're just being completely transparent about our conversations and our recommendations. And but I don't see any reason why we can't convene and provide support anytime Kim needs us to.
Thank you.
I agree. Anyone object? Of course, you know, it might be difficult to arrange, and anyone who doesn't want to participate would, or wasn't available. In either case, you would certainly not have to join.
Anybody? Just let me know when to schedule the Zoom.
Need you, Kathy. All right. What did I do with my agenda? We have 10 minutes left. Dividers, daily life. Anything jumping out on anyone? I'm all over the place here with my notes.
Go ahead, Bianca. The risk stratification, we talked about briefly through emails.
Let's look at those.
Yeah, and then we kind of looked at a few links.
I'm going to share my screen. I think I can do that.
You can.
And let me pull some of them up. This is what you're talking about, right? Okay, so we had talked about a number of things. We had talked about whether or not we should circulate papers, but let's start with this. Everybody should have had a chance to look at these, and then we can, you know, maybe vote and decide which one we like the best. So this is the one that's based on the New York Times. This article was published several months ago, and this company, Information is Beautiful, put it into graphic form. So this was over 500 epidemiologists and other healthcare professionals. I think there were some infectious disease experts as well, were asked to consider various activities and how they considered them, low, medium, or high risk. So this one's a little bit busier than some of the other ones. I like it because it includes factors to consider, like low risk, but avoid crowds. Your friend uses your bathroom, that's low risk, but consider cleaning it afterwards. So it kind of embellishes rather than simply categorizing them. I was a little bit concerned about the fact that it was published by I think this is a for-profit company, but the data come from a good source, and I'm actually confusing myself now. I'm not sure if that is a for-profit company or not. I think it is. Anyway, what do people...
Can you make it larger, Anne, so we can see?
I don't know. Resize.
I'm not sure if I saw the other links. Do we have that in an email?
Yeah, I think I just sent it either last night or this morning. I sent an attachment with all of the links. I'm sorry, I don't know how to make this bigger. I already made it bigger once.
What if you go up and click on view in the whatever you call the thing at the top?
Yeah.
I don't see view. Oh, here we go. Now you can only look at part of it at a time, but tell me if you want me to.
I'm only seeing your
your
white graphics area at this point, and what you haven't clicked open whatever the file is that you are looking at, or at least it's not appearing on my screen.
Mine either.
One, two, three. I see six files that you can choose from having to do with this type of graphic.
Gosh, I don't know what to do.
Can you try double clicking on the file that you thought that you think you have open one more time and see if that pops it? Yeah, right there.
Can you see it now?
No, it's still showing the step prior to fully opening. If you go above where you currently are, see the word view? At the top, it says Manage Picture Tools. Yeah, will that work?
Now what do I do?
No, that's just going to show us the...
Let me go...
You should be able to double-click on that to make it larger. I don't know why it's not opening for you, because your file's not actually fully open.
Let me try another one and see if it works. Can you see this one?
Is it popping up in a background, so you need to select a different screen?
Maybe. Can you see it now?
Not yet. Can you reduce the size of the screen that we're looking at now and see if it's behind it so you can bring it forward?
Let's see.
If you go, what will happen if she goes way over to the right and clicks on that X?
It'll close that whole thing down. If she can reduce it down, maybe try one more over the two boxes, one behind the other, to the left of the X.
Yeah, I did that.
Oh, no, it's not changing for us.
My screen sharing is paused. How did that happen?
Oh.
Let me see if I did that inadvertently.
No, it shouldn't be paused.
I'm going to stop share and start over again.
That might have been it. So it wasn't switching to your new screen for sharing purposes.
Can you see it now?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Well, this is another one. This isn't the one I was talking about, but let's talk about this one. What is this? COVID-19 reopen. I don't think anyone else circulated this. I think this is one I just found on my own. This one only has three experts, so it's a narrower perspective, I would say. I like it because it has all these other factors that you should be considering instead of just looking at you know, going to a certain place, you'll also be thinking about whether it's enclosed, this particular activity, or whether there are crowds, and you'll be reminded to wear a mask. So there's this one. You know, we're coming up on 11:56 now. Do you want me to?
Well, one of the reasons I like this one is because I like the color differentiation that makes it kind of like a stoplight kind of thing, and that it's not so busy as that first one.
Mm-hmm.
I like this one too.
Well, good. I'm glad everybody, well, I'm glad most of you like it, but do you want me to show some other ones? Does anybody have the ability to stay for an extra few minutes or?
I do.
I can.
Yes, I can. And I like this one as well.
Okay.
Yeah, I like it.
All right. And you've seen enough of the 500 epidemiology ones? 500 epidemiologist ones. So this is, somebody sent this one. I forget who it was, but you've seen this one. Can you see the one from Texas now?
No, you'd have
to close out
of this one.
Sorry. What? Two people were talking at once. Somebody tell me what to do. I don't know what the problem is.
I think you have to close out of this one.
Oh, okay. I don't know. Okay, close this one.
Right.
And now share. I think I have to start all over again each time. Can you see it now?
Yep.
Yes.
This is Texas.
And this doesn't have the additional reminders, for example, to wear a mask and consider how many people will be involved and whether it's indoors or outdoors. I really do like having it all in one place.
I think, to me, the issue with this one is like there's no graphics.
Mm-hmm.
So you're like reading down a list, and I don't know if that captures the eye as much as the one with the graphics.
I agree with that.
Yeah, I agree with that. With the only thing is this one, in my personal view and maybe a little bit of knowledge that I've been reading, has a little bit of a better stratification than the other one. For example, they put out gym as high risk. The other one puts gym as moderate to high. A few things from the moderate to the high are a little bit different among those two graphs. But I did like the other one that has more of sort of a visual, a better understanding. But I think this one seems more on point on the risks.
Mm. Okay. Let's see, Texas, Nebraska. We haven't looked at Nebraska yet. Yep, okay, this one is very simple and doesn't have any additional reminders. Where do gyms fit in here? Yeah, gyms fit in pretty high on this one.
We can't see it.
You didn't share it yet.
Sorry. I think that's everything. Any comments on this before I show the other item?
I think I disagree a little with this one. I don't think backyard barbecues are that low risk. That's where we're seeing all these outbreaks from in other places.
What number does that have?
Four.
And it doesn't say, you know, I mean, if it's, you know, four people, that's different from 50 people. That's what I like the ones that have additional reminders. All right, I'm going to close this. And now I'm going to open up. If we decide to go with the Texas one, we decide, you know, content and having the right stratifications is more important than what we liked about some of the other ones. Let me share my screen. I thought that maybe we could, hold on, sorry, people. You can't see it yet, right?
Right.
I thought maybe we could post it along with something like this. If it doesn't have those, if we choose one that doesn't have all of the reminders about things that you need to consider, like the Texas one does not, that we could post it alongside something like this.
I think this one is the least accessible in terms of being able to understand it.
I like numbers 2 and 3.
I can't remember which ones those were, sorry.
That one?
This is 2.
I like that one, and then I like the one Bianca said gave a little bit more detail or stratification.
Okay. Bianca, have you had a chance to look at this and actually look at the stratification? I'm looking at like where would something, your example of the gym, contact sports, that's not exactly the same as, oh.
This one is very user-friendly. I do like that a lot for the public. There's just a little bit of, to me, on the other one, the medium high risk and the high risk. It's like, for example, gyms, it's really high. Hair and nail salons is not the same as a gym, so it's lower. Plane, they think it's already a medium to a high. It's not the way they're doing planes now. And the rest here is mostly, I think, high. So it's just a little bit difference there, the medium high to high, but it's not a big deal, but I think it's very easy to for the public to see.
Well, plus I like the way that under each of these, they list what the risks are.
I like Do we need to be at all concerned that, like it says hair and nail salons are medium high risk, which may be so, but we saw that MMWR report where 139 people in a hair salon all wearing masks did not catch COVID from the two hairdressers that were both positive. So, I mean, does that still keep it in this category, or are we worried that people won't? Is this just saying it's high risk if you don't, or medium high risk if you don't wear a mask, or?
Well, under the risk, it says prolonged close contact and difficult to wear a mask. So my interpretation would be if I had a mask on, that would change my risk.
Sorry, I can't read that.
Okay. This is why I had my cataracts done.
Mm.
So yeah, so this is what I said. I believe that a hair and nail salon, I've been on one, and we are all wearing masks 100% of the time, really. It's much lower risk. And then working in an office also, I would say at this point, most offices, everybody's wearing a mask. It's more of a medium risk. We have like, this is like working in a hospital. When you're working in an office, we all separate wearing masks, and we haven't had among co-workers transmission. And then coffee shops down here and restaurants, it's really not medium high to me. It is high because you're taking your mask off.
Mm. I agree with that. So I have some concerns with this one. I think it's a nice visual, probably the nicest visual, but can we look at the next one again?
Could we ask the authors of this to update it?
let's see.
This is the one with all the just
the list.
Listing. Yeah.
There's all the bars, right?
Yeah. Find your words, Kim.
Okay. This one?
The Texas one.
Yeah.
We just see you, Ann.
Oh, come on. Get with it, program here, Ann.
The one with bars in.
Yeah,
yes, that one.
So this one, I like it a lot. For example, they put working in the office, working a week in the office building as a moderate risk, as I agree. Hair salon in a lower category of moderate to high. Traveling by plane, moderate, and then the buffet, gym, I think churches and other things, live concerts are in the high. But it's not very easy, it's not very visual, right? Like to quickly to understand what it's.
I like this one.
I like this. I just wish it was more visual.
Yes. But it's very accurate, I think, risk stratification there.
Yeah, and I think at the end of the day, we want the content. We want to be comfortable with the content.
Yeah, I agree. The content, it trumps all, if you'll pardon the expression.
Except not everybody reads English, even in Portsmouth.
Mm. Right. Well, this one, I believe, comes in different languages. In Texas, they've got to have a Spanish version. I think this is the one I saw it in different languages. I will have to check on that. I did want to say also that this is the one when I just did a Google search for images, corona risk. This one came up first at the top and was cited. It was posted on a number of different websites. I'm not sure how they do that, but I think that means something. I think that means that more people are trusting this and using this than the others.
Well, I'd like to vote for this one.
Me too.
One thought is when we were discussing masks and signage and whatever, the design group that helped with the streets opening offered to assist with graphics, and I would like to float the idea of asking them to adapt the one with the pictographs, combining the content that's in the Texas one, and see if they have the bandwidth to do anything, and secondly, if they would be interested in that project. Because it sounds like the committee would really like a blend of the two.
But Stephanie, you're the one I thought who said we shouldn't reformat. We would have to cite the Texas Medical Association, I think. How would that work? Because...
Well, there's the question of whether I would not reformat someone else's information. This would basically be creating a Portsmouth stratification of risk chart. I mean, that some of the information is consistent and is also reflected in the governor's guidelines that I think is important. I mean, right now, being in an office is less high risk because we're still under safer at home. So, I mean, either we just share these two documents as public information, as we do with the other resources, or if it's important enough to rise to the level like the FAQs of thinking we may need to blend the resources and come up with a document from the health subcommittee, then I think it would be useful to find out if we even have a graphic designer who could do that gratis.
Is anybody opposed to sharing, just sharing both? I find both to be good. They might have variation on content. However, there's bound to be variation on content or errors, if you will, on it's a moving target. I wouldn't have a problem sharing both.
Kim, I think, and then Kathy.
Oh, well, I think that this is good enough to just use for now, and then we can go to Stephanie's suggestion if we start running into problems. I just think that was just my suggestion.
And
I'd be in favor of that.
Okay, then we haven't answered your question, and I guess now we don't have to, James. Okay, Kathy?
I just want to second that if this is available in other languages, we should post them as well.
Okay. And we would need the task force approval in order to do that, correct?
Yeah, I think this is a nice graph for us to share with the task force and get their approval to post publicly.
All right, then I think we have a plan. I'll send this out along with the meeting notes and the dashboard, and we'll ask for a vote on it tomorrow. And then we'll keep an eye on it and see if we think we need to do something different. Well, thanks for your extra time. Anything else before we close? Okay, thanks everyone.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye.